Okay. So what is the most important building block of a research career? And that's publication, something we all know and love and dread. So I'm going to take you through some tips that we use in telling people how to publish something and get it out there in the best format as possible. Of course, your publication record is the thing that defines your career, defines who you are, and defines your reputation. So this is probably the core that goes to grant committees, that goes to tenure committees, that goes when you apply to jobs, and so it's essential. You have to get the papers out. Sitting on your desk doesn't mean that they count. They don't count until they're in a peer-reviewed journal, and that's the only thing that counts. Most important, not to waste time doing chapters. Chapters are something that you can do when you get old, like myself, and have lots of white hair. As you're early developing your career, don't spend time on them. One more chapter, one less paper. The papers count. Okay, requirements for authorship. There are now requirements that are published by most journals. There's sort of three stages to a research study. One is the conceptualization or the design. The second is acquiring the data. And the third is analysis and interpretation of the data. And then finally writing the manuscript. To be an author on a publication, you must have participated in one of the top three, as well as participated in the manuscript writing. And of course, you have to have had a role in reviewing that final manuscript before it goes in, if your name is going to be on it. There are lots of discussions about authorship, as I'm sure all of you know. That should be revisited at different times during a study. It should be discussed very frankly and in a very business-like fashion at the beginning of a study. The knowledge is, of course, people's roles change over time. Somebody gets sick, somebody leaves, a new person arrives, and so it's important to revisit that as you go along. Okay, selecting a journal is really important. I once had, when I was at NIH, the institute director called me up one day and said, "Why did you publish that article in a low-impact journal?" Well, it happened to be the journal that was important for my field, but the impact score was a 1, and to her that was a total waste of a publication. It probably turned out to be a highly cited publication of mine, but it's certainly your review committees and grant committees will look at how high impact a journal is that you publish in. Why is high impact important? The citation rate for high impact journals is much higher. That's how they get high impact scores, rated based on the citation rate of the articles that they publish. So you want to look at the ratings of each one of the journals. Many of our journals in our field are down at 1s and 2s. That's low impact. Writing for a high impact journal means that you have to make our science attractive to people in other fields. And that's a sell job. And so picking your journal before you write your article is going to be essential, because that's going to determine how you're going to write it. You want to look at the mission statement of a journal. You want to look at the articles that were published in that journal, your topic, or other, which journals are other people publishing in. And there's a program called Jane, which allows you to enter the title or abstract of your paper that you're planning to publish and find journals. And it will find journals based on the content and the words that you use there. I often also do go into Medline and do topics and that are related to my topic and find out which journals some of the recognized leaders of the field are publishing in. Okay, so you've worked your butt off, you've got your data. Where do you start in writing this up? A lot of people sit down and start writing the introduction. Bad thing. Not a good way. An introduction can go on and on and on because there's always more and more data and information to cover. The introduction is going to be one of the last things you write. You're going to start with the results. Take all your data, find out which is the most important data, and organize your results according to that, and spend time on making sure that your figures illustrate your major findings. So you don't want to do tables. Tables are boring. Nobody likes to read them, particularly reviewers of articles. So you want to have figures that make it clear. So not bar graphs, but rather box plots show the variation of a group. You want to demonstrate as much as you can on what happened in the data. So tables I do not do unless I really have to, and often I'll put them in as supplementary material. So box plots never show just means, always standard deviations or standard errors. If it's a repeated measure, people being studied over time, often a line for each subject and show what everybody in the group did. It's a much better way to illustrate a before and after result. After the figures are done, then you will write the results section. And you start off by stating the hypotheses for the study. That will be the end of the introduction, and you're going to go back to the introduction later. But you start off by writing the hypotheses. Why? Because that's what you had to answer, and that's what your results have to address. And so you start off with hypothesis one. What if you have several hypotheses, or two or three? Start with the first hypothesis. What did you find? Have a figure to show that if it was something important. If it was non-significant, don't waste time and space on a non-significant result. Just put it in the text. Write up each one of your hypotheses that were the questions of the study. And as I said, large tables are really not advised. Okay, after the results section is done, then you go to the discussion, because the discussion is taking your results and placing them in science, how they relate to what other people have found, how they change the field, what's the impact of what you found. Don't write up what you're going to plan to do next. That's not important for this study. You want to make sure that you're communicating what your final results were and how they compare with other people's results and how they, what they clarify. Limitations. Put your own limitations in. Don't let the reviewers write it for you. Make sure that you acknowledge what your limitations are and address that in as best you can. And then do the final conclusions. So the discussion is taking your results, putting them in the context of the field, and interpreting them that way, showing where you differ from other people's results and trying to interpret that. Okay, now you go to the introduction. And because you now know exactly where you've gone with this study, and so the introduction is really not a review of the literature, it's an argument for why this study had to be done. What you're doing is a logical argument of so-and-so has found this, so-and-so has found this, these two pieces of results differ. They might differ because of X equal Y, therefore you need and absolutely have to have a study determining whether X equals Y. It's a logical argument on why this study had to be done and what the importance of it is. Because remember, this is going to be the first thing that the reviewer reads. So you want to make sure that the reviewer or any future readers think that this was an important study to do. And you end up with the hypotheses, because that's going to be the thing that you're testing in the study. Okay, methods. Try and keep it as succinct as possible. Sometimes people are replicating something that they did in a previous study, and so you can cite, say, such and such was done similar to and refer to the previous study rather than repeating yourself entirely. If the subjects participated in any other published study, it definitely has to be included in the subject's description that all of these subjects were already studied and published in a previous study. You can't be showing this as though it was a completely novel group of patient subjects. And then organize your your outline for your statistical methods and your data analysis according to the hypotheses. This will make it very easy for the person who's reading this to then go from the introduction, which ends with the hypothesis, the methods, which is organized by the hypotheses, and to the results, which are organized by the same hypothesis. This makes it much easier for reviewers and readers to follow the findings in the study. The abstract is the last thing you write, and remember, the abstract is going to be the selling point of this study. It has to not summarize the study, it has to make it important for somebody to want to read it. Remember, most of your readers are going to do a Medline search or Scopus search, they're going to get titles. And then they might, if they're interested in the title, open the abstract. The abstract is where they make the critical decision of whether they're going to go and read that article or not. So your abstract has to sell it. You, first of all, it should be succinct, but there should be a final conclusion on why this is important. People often forget that you're not just summarizing the research, you're saying why that research is important. Okay. The next step is you have to send it to all your co-authors, make sure that they agree with it, and get their permission to submit it. You absolutely have to have their written permission before you can submit anything with their name on it. Then people often forget the essential point of selling it to the editor of the journal. So the letter to the editor when you submit an article is absolutely essential. You want to sell your study, say why it's important to their readership, and why they would be interested, how many of their readers might be of interest to might be finding this a significant study. And then you recommend reviewers. Now, usually an editor might pick one of your reviewers, so don't expect that everybody you list as potential reviewers, and they usually ask you for three, is going to be asked. And of course, most reviewers are very busy, so they might ask one of your reviewers, and your reviewer is busy doing their grant proposal at that time, they're not going to review it. So you can't always expect that the people you list are going to be the people reviewing it. Don't red flag people, that is, say people you don't want to review it unless you have to. That sort of gives a bad taste in people's mouths. You can red flag people if you feel that it's absolutely essential. Okay, revisions. As long as they don't totally out reject the paper, you should revise it and send it back. And when you revise and send back, be very responsive. Reviewer one, list all their comments. After each comment, what have you done in this manuscript to address that comment? And sometimes you may want to justify something that you did, but still add that justification into the manuscript too, so it shows you were responsive in addressing their concerns. And always say where you did it. The reviewer is not going to want, and when they get this back, they're not going to want to wade through the 20-page article to find out where you changed your reference to so-and-so. Always give the page and the line number of where you made that change. If you're rejected, I can't tell you how many people, like myself, have received rejections. You've taken all the suggestions and the complaints of the previous reviewers. You've made it a much better article and then send it to another journal and had it accepted. Sometimes you go through two or three journals before you finally get it accepted, but think of what better, it's a much better manuscript, a much better product after you've gone through all those revisions. So unless it's a complete disaster, somebody found something you didn't control, it's a real turkey and you don't want to ever get it in print, always keep revising and resubmitting. And the fatal flaw, if it's got a fatal flaw, bury it, just let it die in that bottom drawer.